We have received the notification from Mr. Jonathan Ho, chairman, who said that he's sick and he can't be here today. And Mr. Eddie Chu can not be here either. He's the deputy chairman. So according to the rules of procedure, well, a member has reminded me that I would be presiding over the meeting first. And I would ask members that if the chairman and the deputy chairman are absent, during their absence, a member can be elected to take up their duties to chair the meeting. So anyone, any nomination for the chairman today? Mr. Vincent Zhang? I accept the nomination. Any other nomination? Any objection? If there is no other nomination, no objection. So I'll stand in the place of Mr. Jonathan Ho to chair this particular meeting on the panel on manpower. So we've got the appointed time and we formed a quorum. So let's get started with the meeting today. Item 1, information papers issued since the last meeting. Since last meeting, the Secretariat has issued 2 information papers. They are Mr. Andrew WAN wrote in on the 3rd of April expressing his concern about the treatment for outsourced contract staff in view of the closure of LCSD venues. And the second letter is submitted by Dr. Pierre CHAN on the 13th of May, suggesting that the panel be discussing the COVID-19 situation, the relevant employee protection, and listing that disease as an occupational disease under the Employment Compensation Ordinance. All right, dates of next meeting and items for discussion. The list of outstanding items for discussion. We have a regular meeting to be held on the 16th of June, a Tuesday. There are 2 items proposed for discussion. One is the Hong Kong's occupational safety performance and also review of the improvement measures for non-skilled employees engaged by government service contractors. So any views on the agenda items for the June meeting? If not, then let's go to the proper the agenda proper. 3rd item, latest development in the employment services of the Labour Department. So first, let's invite the government representatives to join us. All right, the government team is filing in. Please refer to paper submitted by the administration, LC paper number CB(2968/1920)03. So, Mr. Carlson Chen, Commissioner for Labour, can you please walk us through the paper, please? Thank you, Chairman and members. On the latest development in employment service of the Labour Department, and the details are set in the paper submitted, so I'll highlight a few salient points. In view of the latest economic situation in Hong Kong, the COVID-19 epidemic, adverse impact has been imposed on the labor market. In view of the worsening employment situation in the second half of 2020, the LD will implement the Employment Program for the Elderly and Middle-Aged, EPM, Youth Employment and Training Program, YETP, and Work Orientation and Placement Scheme, WOPS. We will increase the on-the-job training subsidy allowance to encourage employers to employ old people, young people, and PWDs, and provide on-the-job training to them. Under this scheme, the maximum amount of allowance payable to employers will be $60,000 per employee, and for those aged 60 or above participating in these programs, young people and the PWDs, and to encourage them to stay on the job for a longer time, we will also the dispersing a retention allowance to them to encourage them to stay longer in the job, to finish the on-the-job training to stabilize the labor market. So every employee may receive a maximum of $12,000 in retention allowance. For ethnic minorities, EMs, to strengthen employment support for EM job seekers, LD will, in the later half of this year, will launch a pilot program in conjunction with NGOs to provide a one-stop employment services for EM job seekers through a case management approach. Now, in view of the COVID-19 epidemic, a lot of the face-to-face services have to be suspended, but LD has continued in canvassing job vacancies and vetting job vacancies, and through telephone employment service center and mobile apps, we continue to disseminate information on job vacancies to job seekers so they can, through such apps, seek jobs. The IES and the different centers, hotlines, continue to operate during this period. And through the telephone, we have provided advisory and referral services to job seekers. As the epidemic stabilizes, on starting the 4th of May, the LD has resumed and organizing small-scale job fairs and also industry-specific job fairs. We will continue to monitor the situation of the epidemic, and where conditions permit, we will resume organizing larger job fairs. For job seekers with employment difficulties, in particular the elderly, the young people, and the EMs and PWDs, we have launched a number of measures to help them seek jobs. For the elderly job seekers, apart from enhancing the employer's allowance under the EPEM and dispersing retention allowance for those aged 60 or above, we will continue to stage job fairs for the elderly where the conditions permit. And in our employment centers, we have set up special counters and organized district-based job fairs for them. And we also established a dedicated webpage for elderly job seekers and provide them with the relevant information. For young people, under YETP, in 2019-20, we have launched a new phase of employment project Career Kickstart, which targets young people with special needs, with low educational attainment, emotional or behavioral problems, learning difficulties, or suffering from prolonged unemployment.
Participating NGOs would receive subsidy from the government in offering on-job training of 12 months' duration to these trainees with a view to enhancing their employability. And under YETP, in January this year, we have also increased the subsidy per trainee so as to encourage the participation of young people to join in our scheme. The Selective Placement Division of the Labor Department provides personalized employment services for job seekers with disabilities fit for open employment. From September of 2019, we have started to provide a special emotional counseling to needy job seekers with disabilities registered with the SPD to help to alleviate the emotional problems arising from the state of their disabilities or personal or family matters so as to help them concentrate on job search and settle in their new jobs. for ethnic minorities, we continue to provide dedicated services for EM job seekers. And we also invite them to become our ambassador under the Employment Services Ambassador Program for those who can communicate in EM languages. We have also recruited full-time EM with the downward turn in the economy and the development of COVID-19 epidemic, the labor market has suffered hugely. The Labor Department will continue to monitor the development and review the provision of our employment services so that enhancements will be initiated in a timely manner so as to better serve the needs of both job seekers and employers. Now, this is my briefing on the paper, and I invite members to give their views. Four minutes each. Mr. Andrew Wan. Thank you, Chairman. In the paper, during the on-job training period, you would receive $3,000 in the first 3 months, and then for each consecutive month, then you would receive an allowance until for $4,000 to $5,000 for a period of 6 to 12 months. So, is the subsidy given to the employer on the employee? So, and they get the allowance right after 3 months, or how long does it take? I'm asking this question because you encourage the employee to stay. Yet, you delay the allowance given to them. It's really not much encouragement at all. So how can or when can they really receive this allowance? Another question is on EMs. I'd like to ask about the standards for recruitment right now. Of course, I know that you want to find someone with experience. Some organizations have experience in helping job seekers, yet they have never really assisted EM job seekers. So would you have some sort of guidelines or standards for that, Commissioner? Thank you, Mr. Wan, for your questions. The OJT allowance will be directly given to the employees, or the retention allowance will also be given to them. But first of all, they need to first work for 3 months. And after 3 months, they will be offered a retention allowance. And for every additional allowance, if they stay in the OJT post, then they would be given $1,000 extra. We hope that, of course, it would be given as soon as possible. This is the responsibility of the Labor Department. We have a clear list of the participating employers, and therefore there shouldn't be too much problem with the flow. Well, I just want to be reassured. Thank you. We are setting up a pilot scheme for NGOs to provide them with more personalized services. We hope that for those with experience or those with experience with EMs, they will be able to assist in the pilot program. We will consider all these aspects In the design of our program, we discussed this with the organizations to see how they can provide assistance. Therefore, when we are selecting or looking into the criteria, we have already considered all their views. We hope we'll be able to launch this pilot program as soon as possible. I'm just worried, Chairman, that it might lead to new problems. You might be providing very good service for the EMs, yet you do not have experience in job seeking. So I do want to follow up on the progress of this pilot program. Yes, I hope that the Labor Department will consider all these aspects. Next, Mr. Pun Xiuping. Thank you, Chairman. Yesterday, the Secretary gave a press briefing on the ESS scheme. I actually am concerned with the unemployment rate because I'm sure that it will skyrocket in the near future. The Secretary said that in the next 2 years, there would be employment opportunities for about 30,000 jobs, and you want to also assist those who are unemployed to find new jobs. I want to know how many vacancies there are in the Labor Department right now. Or I know that you have retained services. If you're creating 30,000 posts, then would the 13 service centers under the Labor Department also help with job matching? Under the epidemic, you have suspended certain services, yet you still provide telephone services. So how many people have you assisted in job seeking? And starting from May 4th, you have already resumed district-based job fairs and recruitment activities. How many of such activities have you organized since then? Even Cathay Pacific is laying off staff. This is actually quite worrying. What can you really do other than enhancing the scheme for the elderly and middle-aged young people and persons with disabilities? With a higher unemployment rate, what are some of the new policies or measures you can adopt to help the unemployed to seek jobs? Commissioner. The economy has seen a downturn in the world recently. Vacancies in Labor Department has seen a drop compared to the same time last year. Some vacancies for private organizations in the first 4 months, we're talking about 180,000, out of which around 20,000 are part-time jobs. During this time, in the first 4 months of this year, there have been around 32,000 successful cases in job seeking. The economy has affected the number of jobs, yet we have seen successes of 32,000 cases in the first 4 months, which is quite an achievement. We know the economy will be even worse, and therefore we are going to continue to work on employment opportunities. We know that some groups of people, such as the elderly, middle-aged, young people, and persons with disabilities, find it difficult to find employment. Therefore, we are going to increase the on-the-job training allowance from $4,000 per month to $5,000 per month. We hope this would be conducive in their hire, and that they can also learn much from the on-the-job training. Mr. Xiu Ka-chun, thank you, Chairman. The Commissioner kept on saying that we are in dire straits, that the unemployment is 5%. It's actually a record high in a decade. And I do think that it's a difficult period for many groups. And some of them suffer more than others. As mentioned by the Commissioner, the elderly, the middle-aged, young people, and persons with disabilities. When I worked as a social worker, I was already very concerned with youth unemployment. It's actually three times more the unemployment rate. I also want to touch on unemployment rate in young people right now. I see that a survey has been done on a website recently on young people. 530 young people have been interviewed. 60% of the respondents are worried about their economic situation. 20% of them only have enough to last for a month, and about only 11% only have enough to last for 2 weeks. And right now we see a huge wave of close downs and unemployment. Young people think that there should be changes made to the YETP. Those between the age of 15 to 24 should actually be relaxed to 15 to 29. Of course, we don't know whether YETP should be extended to high flyers such as college graduates. They actually target those who find it difficult to find jobs for those S4 leavers. I don't quite agree with this recommendation of extending the YETP, yet I want to hear what the Commissioner thinks about this suggestion. Well, you say that there would be a larger retention allowance. Our training allowance is actually from 8,300 to 9,300. That's not a lot. Mr. Pun Xiuping also asked whether there would be more concrete or revolutionary measures that you can adopt.
Commissioner, please. The member mentioned some figures and also about the youth unemployment rate. He has been clear in pointing out that generally youth unemployment rate is higher than the average. In Hong Kong, it may not be as many as three times. The latest figures show that in January to March this year, the overall unemployment rate is 4.2%. And for a young person, age 15 to 24, the unemployment rate is 10%, two times more. And then the Federation of Youth Groups suggested that the YETP be extended to coverage, to cover more age groups. Let's look at the positioning of the YETP. We set out to help those with employment difficulties. If we look at the unemployment figures, for those aged 15 to 24. Well, this is a group, target group of YETP. The unemployment rate is indeed high, 10%. We look at other age groups, 25 to 29. The unemployment rate was 5.1% in the last quarter. Compared to the overall 4.2%, it was just slightly higher. For those really young, 15 to 24, they are just fresh from the college. They don't have much experience, work experience. So in the work market, it might be difficult for them to find a suitable market. They face greater difficulties than those aged between 25 and 29. This latter group will have higher academic qualification and more experience. It may be easier for them to find jobs. So the unemployment rate also reflects that this is true. So we would like to focus our efforts and resources on YETP to help those between age between 15 to 24, where we keep close tabs on the figures, and if there are further changes and if needed, we are willing to make the adjustment. But for now, we believe that the present arrangement should be maintained. As to whether there are bolder measures, apart from raising the OJT allowance for employers to encourage them to hire more young people, we also hope that young people, when once they are placed in a job, they can stay in the position for a longer time. So that's why we will disperse a retention allowance for them. So $3,000 for the first 3 months, an additional allowance of $1,000 for an extra month, and they can get a maximum of 12-month subsidy. So this is a bolder initiative, innovative initiative. So we hope that young people can get a job, and apart from that, they can stay longer in their posts and accumulate more experience. If members have other suggestions on how to help young people get a job, then we are more than happy to listen to them. Dr. Helena Wong. Chairman, we noticed that the Labour Department has launched a number of measures to help people who need a job. You will be helping the most vulnerable groups. I agree that they should be assisted. Apart from young people, elderly, middle-aged, PWDs and EMs. I find it strange that you have not come up with an analysis on women employment situation. And do you have any statistics on employment as broken down by the gender? I believe that the LWB is looking after the implementation of gender mainstreaming. Why is the gender analysis lacking here? That's the first question. Second question on EM. In Kowloon West, there are a lot of EM groups, Nepalese and Indians and Palestinians, Pakistanis living there. And you would launch a pilot program. You would identify an NGO through tender and ask them to match jobs against the EM job seekers. You said that you are starting the tender now, and that will only be launched in the latter half of 2020. What is the target number of EMs you would like to help? And what is the target to be achieved in terms of number of job seekers to be helped? Commissioner, about women employment. We do not have a separate plan for women workers. There is no separation in terms of gender. Women, maybe they have to take care of their family. they might find it, they may have faced more constraints if they are to rejoin the labor market compared to men. So in job fairs in the past years and in a various support programs, there is one thing very special. We offer part-time jobs. For a family, maybe the children have grown up and the children and the FDH is engaged or hired to take care of the family. Some of them can work full-time, but others can't work full-time. They can only take a part-time job. So in job fairs, part-time jobs are offered to women and also elderly. Some elderly don't want full-time jobs. Commissioner, well, during the different stages of their life, women may work on a different mode. And if the children are young, they may work part-time. But the children have grown up, they may have stopped working for a while. They would like to work full-time again. So there are different types of women out there seeking jobs. So don't think that all women would like to be casual workers. Maybe for middle-aged women, they would like to rejoin the labor force. They face great difficulties. They need your assistance. Like I said, some women would like to seek part-time jobs. We have plans to support them to do so. And for middle-aged, senior-aged women, when their children have grown up, they would like to take on part-time, full-time jobs again. So for the EPAEM, they can also cover women. After we have implemented the minimum wage, statutory minimum wage, more women are joining the labor force. After the statutory minimum wage has been implemented, women's participation rate in the labor force has risen. So our EPEM is indeed helping women to rejoin the labor market. And what about my question on EM pilot program? What is the target of job seekers to be helped? We will not be too ambitious in the initial stage. We would like to help 500 EM job seekers through this program. We will adopt a case management approach, so we will help them seek jobs. We will provide counseling to them. And after they are placed on a job, the NGO will play an important role in helping them communicate with their employers so that the job seekers can get satisfaction in their jobs and also they can remain in their jobs for a longer time. For employers who haven't had the experience of working with EMs, they need a third party to help them. Well, 500 is too small a number. In Kowloon West, of even 5,000 will not be enough. I hope that you can increase the number. Dr. Fernando Zhang, Chairman. The unemployment rate just released now reaches a record high in 10 years. Over 200,000 people are out of job. Underemployment rate has also risen drastically to 3.1%, a record high in 15 years. This is not good news at all. And I hope that this isn't the worst yet. The epidemic is somehow under control now, but we see that for many service sectors, well, it will be quite some time before things can return to normal. So the unemployment situation will persist. The Labor Department has all along provided a lot of job placement services and job referral services. But the Audit Commission released a report last year saying clearly that the Labour Department, in terms of the number of people participating in your placement program and also the ratio of people who stayed in their jobs after placement, is the rate is rather low, and the service users number has dropped year by year too. I've also asked for some figures in the budget questions. Your answer shows that from 2015, for those who have participated in your programs and found a job, well, in 2015, it's 14,000. It's dropped to 8,000 last year. This is most worrying. The unemployment rate has hit a record high, but the Audit Commission report said that your service level has decreased in terms of the number of service users, the efficiency, the staying in the job, and so on. The rate has been on the low side. So I'm worried about how you will deal with the problem of the extremely high unemployment rate. And the most disastrous areas are like the catering, construction, hotel industries and sector and so on. Do you have any strategies to help those who will lose their job? You said you will allocate funds to, say, hire some people on a short-term basis. For the newly created posts, are they suited, these people, to those who are going out of job? Do you and the LWB have a strategy? And also in the supplementary labor program, you are still sticking to your old approach. But in my budget questions, I've also asked something about the supplementary labor scheme and the manpower. You said you would increase the manpower involved and the recurrent expenditure will also rise. It will be doubled in the coming year. The amount is not substantial here. When the local workers are facing unemployment problem, would you still go ahead with the supplementary labor scheme?
Commissioner, thank you. The referral numbers have been low. I mean those that were directly referred by the labor department with successful job placements. We reiterated time and time again that with such technological advancement, many employers and job seekers would go through the website or through their cell phones for job placements. They don't really need to register with the LD for referral of jobs or for job matching. Very often, they see it online, and when they find something they're interested in, then they would approach the employer directly. We see many of the cases find jobs through this way, and they necessarily need to come in person to the Labor Department for registration and referral. This is actually the new trend. Many people are expert in the use of smartphones. Oh, I'm sorry to interrupt, but do you have any figures if an employer has registered with the LD, would you follow up after a while. Perhaps the job was taken by someone who used the website to contact the employer directly. Well, we do have some figures. For those who register with us, we do have the figures, and we would also question the employers whether they have successful hires after registering on our website. In 2019, direct referrals reach 8,100. Our follow-up survey finds that there are 110,005 people who found jobs through online. So there are over 115,000. Any other questions? Can I ask a second round? Well, I'll ask first. I'm sure many of you are concerned with job-seeking services. Now, the unemployment rate is 5.2%, which means 250,000 people are unemployed. We do not see a large aging population, yet there is such a high unemployment rate. This shows that many people are not in the labor force. My view is that other than COVID-19 being a reason, the black violence still continues. You see the violence starting from this year, and it still continues this year. I still see people damaging shops and shopping malls. I remember a mainland tea shop that was damaged quite a few times, and it finally closed down. I'd like to ask the commissioner a question. Do you think the government is underestimating the unemployment rate and that it is higher than 5.2%? Because our view is that we are now more desperate than during SARS. You say the number is 5.2%, but is this actually an underestimate? Well, last time, 3 months, you said there's a reduction of 30,000, and now you said within a month, there's around 8,000. So where did the people go? Thank you, Chairman. It's very hard for me to say whether the government has underestimated the number. We did a survey on unemployment, and it was done in an efficient manner. I'm sure that the Census Department adopted a scientific method in the estimate. It may be one of the reasons why Hong Kong suffers. We not only suffer from the new coronavirus, where although the unemployment rate is still not yet as high as during SARS period, we see recently that employers are trying not to lay off employees immediately. Instead, they have adopted other measures to buy time in the hope that the economy will recover soon, such as taking no paid leave, reducing working hours, and so on. The This is actually a good phenomenon. Well, I understand, Commissioner. I'd like you to do something. You really must work on a survey to understand the situation of the unemployed. Don't just give us some figures and tell us that 200,000 people are unemployed. We need to know the reasons for their unemployment and what hopes they have for the future. Oh, you might need to provide more subsidy. This is something you need to do. You need to follow up and see why they're unemployed. Can you actually suspend the import of laborers for a certain period of time? We do not have enough jobs right now. Why is there still a need to import workers? In the past, it's difficult to hire people to work in residential care homes for the elderly. But I'm sure that now, if you're willing to pay them a reasonable salary, then you'll be able to find workers. We're not trying to we try not to replace local labor. We want to give priority to local people. For employers who like to apply to import workers through the supplementary labor scheme, they must comply with the criteria that they're unable to hire suitable workers in Hong Kong. As you may well know, hiring someone through the supplementary labor scheme will need a pay or an average pay, and you also need to support their accommodation. Well, yes, I have heard all this before, Commissioner. In reality, the unemployment is at an all-time high, and I'm sure that the number is even higher. I'm sure you'll be able to hire someone locally, unless you really don't want to hire them. I know people who give excuses not to hire local people because they can try to undermine the import workers. I think that during these difficult times, the Labor Department must first ensure local employment. All right, second round next, Dr. Fernando Cheng. Thank you, Chairman. I was touching on this point earlier as well. Unemployment is really high in Hong Kong right now. Therefore, it is really not appropriate to import workers. We already do not have enough work. Why do we still hire people from outside? Oh, the Labor Department says that for those who are hired during via the supplementary labor scheme, you will need to provide accommodation for them and to provide them with a median salary. Well, I'm familiar with the residential care homes for the elderly. Actually, they like to hire outsiders because they can take part of their salary. You say one thing, yet in reality, it's a different matter in the market. No employer would hire import workers if they are not able to reduce their expenses. So I suggest you not to work or continue with the supplementary labor scheme. The most direct way to help unemployed is to provide them with an unemployment subsidy. What you're doing now, right now, is to pay them via the employer, which is really not reasonable because I don't think you can really retain the employment, or maybe you can retain the number, yet you're not able to retain the earnings. Although 3.1 is not a high number, but the last time the number is only 2.1% for underemployment. Well, that is really serious. You're now facing high unemployment, and for certain industries, the situation is even more harsh. Well, I shouldn't deviate and talk about unemployment subsidy. However, special schemes for the elderly, the middle-aged, young people, and persons with disabilities, you may have looked into that. However, there is still high unemployment. Do you have any plans? Or for some who may need retraining or add value, do you have some sort of plans for them, or you just continue with what you have been doing usually? Commissioner, thank you. We provide assistance targeting the different groups faced with the downward economy and the impact by the pandemic. We need to open up more recruitment. The Labor Department does not have the responsibility to open up new jobs. Our responsibility lies in helping the unemployed to find jobs. What we do is to job match. We are going to try our best to contact the employers, especially those who have used our services before. We will contact them directly and see whether there is appropriate or suitable employment openings that can be advertised at the Labor Department. And we could also reach out to other media. Some employers choose to use other media to show their job openings, yet they do not register with us. We will try to reach out to employers to use our services and to register with us, because I see that our website is one of the most popular for job seekers.
We will take more initiative to do outreaching. We'll proactively reach out to the employers. And despite the economic difficulty, I believe that a lot of employers are still looking to hire people, so we will do our best. Mr. Kwok Wai Kang. Thank you, Chairman. The Commissioner has said the most important thing. There is a lot of unemployment, so theoretically, a lot of people will approach the LD for assistance. But then we are now in economic recession. We don't have enough jobs to go around. So the Labor Department will not have a heavier workload because there are no jobs forthcoming. So how are you going to deploy your manpower in that case? There will be more cases, in particular in the area of labor disputes. because a lot of workers are now on no pay leave. After they have taken the no pay leave, and if business turns to be better, then that is good. But then after the no pay leave, if the business closes down, so how can the workers or the employees protect their own rights? How can they chase the employers for the payments due to them? Has the LD, how many such labor dispute cases has the Labor Department handled? How would you communicate more with the employers so that they know better their own rights? I think a lot of workers are now on no pay leave. So do you have any measures to tackle the problem when it surfaces later? Like I said, some employers don't want to lay off staff immediately. They would negotiate with the employees, and they would ask the employees to go on no pay leave. They don't want to sack them immediately, but that there is a precondition. And that is if employers want the employees to take no pay leave. Such an arrangement has to be agreed by both the employers and the employees. If there is no consensus and the employers force the employees to take no pay leave, then he will be breaching the relevant employment law. And you are also breaching unilaterally the contractual terms in the employment agreement. So the contract will become invalid, and you are in fact sacking the employee, and you will have to make compensation in accordance with the law. Sorry to interrupt you, Commissioner. I don't think you're being sympathetic here. I don't think there is agreement usually between the employers and employees in asking the employees to take no pay leave. Employees normally are not willing to take no pay leave. They have to pay their rent. They have to pay for school fees of their children. So in fact, they don't agree with it, but that's nothing they can do about it. So if the boss or if the business closes down in the future, then can the employee take the case to the LD as if it is one where he is dismissed by the employer instead of he resigning on his own? I think we have to look at the individual cases. If an employee is asked by the employer to take no pay leave, and after a period, he can't his duties are not resumed, and his interest or right is being adversely affected, he can seek assistance from the LD. In principle, such an arrangement has to be agreed by both sides, and if that is not the case, the contractual terms are breached, and the employer has to make compensation in accordance with the law. But let me emphasize that we have to look at the cases on a case-by-case basis. Commissioner, well, let's discuss this. I would like to tap on your knowledge. The labor law says that if there is any agreement which breaches the contractual terms, then the agreement should be deemed as invalid. Now, in terms of no pay leave arrangement, if the employee doesn't agree to it, of course, the employer also always has the say, and well, maybe later the employee seeks help from the Labor Department saying that he is forced to resign on his own. So will the Labor Department invoke the relevant article in the legislation saying that your so-called agreement back then is a breach of the employment ordinance and this should be considered as invalid? So like I said, we have to look at the individual, the cases, circumstances of each individual case. If the evidence shows that the employer contravenes the labor legislation, we will help the employee to chase after the employee in accordance with the labor regulation and even prosecute the employer. While the labor departments must ensure that it has sufficient manpower to handle labor disputes and take employers breaching the law to court. Now, we are discussing employment support here, but we don't want to see employees going out of job. So, Mr. Pin Xiuping, second round. Just now, I asked the commissioner whether he has new measures to deal with the unemployment situation now, and how can you work more effectively? Of course, I don't object to enhancing existing programs, but I also agree with what other members said. You should create short-term posts and also stop the SLS, Supplementary Labor Scheme. I would like to follow up on one thing. I've said in the budget that $30 million will be set aside to benefit 4,000 people. I think that this has to do with the use of the resources of the EPEM. Last year, so you serve only 3,000 people only. Now the figure has been pushed up to 4,000. You are seeing fewer and fewer jobs, and I think it's difficult for you to increase the number. For 2020 and 2021, you said you're going to help 4,000 people. How can you achieve this target as set down in the budget speech of the FS? Thank you. Commissioner, can I defer to Mr. Hui, please? Thank you, Member, for your question. For the beneficiary number of 4,000, it was arrived after considering the 3,000 people this year, and that number covers EPEM, YETP, and WOPS beneficiaries. For 2019, well, there were already some 3,000 beneficiaries. After we enhanced the programs, we envisaged that the number of beneficiaries will rise up because we are dispersing a higher allowance and more employers expected to hire people under these programs. In the budget, after it has been released, we have taken a look at the employment market. For the EPEM, we originally increased the allowance for those job seekers aged over 60. For those aged 40 to 59, they are also facing a hard time and seeking jobs. So we are also allowing, increasing their allowance amount from 3,000 to 4,000. So that was proposed after the budget was released. We envisage that 800 additional job seekers will benefit. Now, 3,061 are under EPM, YETP 942, and YETP 2046. So it's a total of 6,700. So we are having 2,007 fewer people. You increase the allowance, but then the number of people will go down. Why is that? So you will be achieving the target of 4,000 this year only? Thank you, member, for your question. For EPEM, the member mentioned 3,000. That is the number of cases meeting the eligibility criteria. These are the eligible people. So if employers take on these people, they are eligible for the allowance. But among these 3,000 cases, a lot of employers might not apply for the allowance. In 2019, only 800 employers applied for the allowance. So in 2019, for the three employment programs and their beneficiaries, there are some 3,700 cases. For EPEM, I hope that the commissioner can review whether the threshold is appropriate. I heard from some employers that the process is quite complicated and they're not willing to apply. Please review that. Mr. Yu Si-wing, on the employment situation in Hong Kong, the unemployment rate has risen, and the LD will take out advertisements to encourage employers to hire people. But I think it's easier to hire people these days. I think the crux is how to encourage employers to hire more people. The ESS has been launched. I hope that it will be effective. Under our present circumstance, then people would not like you to import workers. There is no need because people can't find a job here. That's very obvious. But SLS is a long-term policy. We should not adjust it just because we are facing the difficulties this year. Please wait and see. Some members have asked the government to stop importing labor immediately. Let's be more pragmatic here. SLS is not for the sake of cutting costs. We've been facing a shortage of laborers and professionals in the past few years. So through this SLS, we would like to address these issues. The cost for importing workers is not low. You have to give them the pay, the allowance, and also the accommodation. For a local worker, the cost is lower. The business sector and some sectors in particular are asking for workers to be imported because of manpower shortage. The government can review its import policy on importation of labor, and after 1 year, you can take a look at the situation of various sectors, whether there is a manpower shortage, and so on. You can conduct a review. We should not rush into changing the labor importation policy just because of the latest unemployment situation. You should not take across-the-board approach. You should not just rush into changing the policy because of the high unemployment rate now.
Commissioner, thank you for your suggestion. We do have the same plan. We did see in the past few months that there have been a reduction in the number of applications. The workers through the supplementary labor scheme, even at the peak, only reached a number of 5,000. It is a low number compared to our overall labor force. And these people are mainly in agriculture sector or working in the residential care homes for the elderly. It's difficult for us to hire these people locally. Some of them may produce tofu because they will need to get up very early in the morning to work, and it's difficult to find people to work in this industry. And there has been a low number of construction workers via this scheme, unless it's a major construction such as the airport. A mandatory 4-week local hire together with the salary not lower than the median salary, we would continue to act as a gatekeeper to uphold with our principle of prioritizing local employment. And only when we are unable to make local hires will we seek workers via the supplementary labor scheme. All right, we have discussed this for a long time and we have actually use more time than expected. We now move on to agenda item 4, which is the latest development in the formulation of sector-specific working hours guidelines and relevant initiatives. Please refer to the paper CB bracket 2968/1920/05 and LC paper per CB bracket 2968/1920/06 on the updated background brief prepared by the Electrical Secretariat. May I now invite Ms. Mabel Lipo, E-Deputy Commissioner for Labour, to take us through the paper. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to first brief you on the paper. The last term government endorsed the report and recommendations of the Standard Working Hours Committee as a general framework for guiding the future formulation of the working hours policy and adopted the following implementation framework to take forward the recommendations, including adopting a wage line of monthly wages, and also to drop specific working hours guidelines. However, the community had divergent views on legislative proposals on regulating working hours. Without a consensus, the government in 2018 decided not to pursue the two legislative proposals on contractual working hours and mandatory overtime compensation, and to first focus efforts on formulating working hours guidelines for 11 designated sectors and assessing the effectiveness of the guidelines through household surveys on working hours situation. The government would also explore the feasibility of putting in place supportive measures to improve the working hours arrangements of employees. Chairman, under the sector-specific working hours guidelines, we formulated them through the Labour Department's industry-based tripartite committees. We also looked into the SDVHC's recommendation to set up tripartite discussions for the cleaning services and elderly home sectors. We discussed on the definition of specific working hours and also on working hours arrangement and overtime hours. We want to formulate guidelines that could best suit the needs of the sectors for the different employers and employees and to improve their working hours arrangements. Ever since the tripartite committee started the discussion, the LD, together with the tripartite committees and their members, held many meetings to exchange ideas and negotiate on an agreement. As there's huge variety in the different sectors and industries, the tripartite committees have had many different discussions, and there have been divergent views on the working hours arrangement. The LD is making its best efforts to narrow down the differences and to seek a consensus. In Annex 1 of our paper, we set out the formulation of guidelines in respect of the designated sectors. The pandemic has also affected our meetings. We will proactively engage members of the tripartite committees as soon as the pandemic starts to die down. Now, I would like to share with you the progress of the household survey on working hour situation. In 2014, the Standard Working Hours Committee conducted the first ever territory-wide comprehensive working hour survey. The government decided that before full implementation of the sector-specific working hours guidelines, to first monitor the working hours trend of employees in general and capture detailed data on the working hours of employees of different sectors, particularly the 11 sectors for which sector-specific working hours guidelines are formulated, thereby facilitating a review of the effectiveness of the guidelines upon implementation. After an open tendering procedure, the LD commissioned a service contractor to conduct a new round of household survey on working hours situation. We originally planned to commence the field work in February. However, it was postponed due to the COVID-19 pandemic. We will closely monitor the development of the pandemic and aim to kickstart the field work later this year. And based on preliminary assessment, the survey results will be released in the second half of 2021. On another hand, to promote the culture of reasonable working hours arrangements, enhance the transparency of the terms of employment, and improve the communication between employers and employees in respect of working hours, the Labor Department has introduced some measures. We encourage employers to place job vacancies through the LD. We have also enhanced the template of our sample contract and updated the booklet using written employment contract, which is set out in Annex 2, and it could help enrich the content relating to working hours arrangements. The LD will closely monitor the development of the pandemic and resume meetings of the tripartite committees with a view to narrowing down differences so as to reach a consensus as soon as possible. When the guidelines are released, the LD will actively promote them to the industries and also launch timely education and publicity activities to promote the culture of reasonable working hours arrangements and good working hours management measures. The government will also, 3 years after the release of all the 11 sector-specific working hours guidelines, conduct a stock take and assess the effectiveness of the measures and further explore feasible ways to improve the working hours policy. Thank you. Mr. Poon Siu-Ping.
Thank you, Chairman. We have always asked for legislation of standard working hours. The report and recommendations of the Standard Working Hours Committee did not have any representative from the worker side, and I think that there is still a delay here. If you look at the last paragraph of the paper, which is paragraph 11 on the way forward, this paragraph sets out that there is only going to be a stock take after 3 years, which means to say that if we want to formulate legislation, it will take a very long period of time. I'd like to take this opportunity, however, to ask questions in relation to the paper. Deputy Commissioner, you said that through the tripartite committees, there are around 11 sectors working out the working hours guideline, and it is also set up in Annex 1. In paragraph 7, it is also mentioned that the LD will proactively engage members of the tripartite committees to continue the discussions upon the amelioration of the pandemic situation, and you aim to issue progressively working hours guidelines for sectors that could reach consensus within this year. I want to ask whether you'll be able to issue the guidelines for phase one in this year, which is a sector covering catering, clean service, construction, logistics, retail, hotel, and tourism, or would it also cover the other sectors included in these 11 sectors? How do you set out the guidelines. Let's say you do not reach a consensus. Would you still issue guidelines? Thirdly, you also mentioned that in 2019 October, you commissioned a service contracted to conduct a new round of household survey. However, it has to be delayed due to the pandemic. I want to know how much money will be needed for this survey. Would it actually be a survey based on house visits? And you are looking into releasing the survey results in the second half of 2021. Well, since the fieldwork has not yet been begun, when can you really actually start with this round of survey? Deputy Commissioner, thank you, Chairman, and thank you for your questions. First of all, in Annex 1, we've listed out the 11 sector-specific guidelines which have been discussed with these 11 sectors. And this is the progress of the tripartite committees. We have divided up into three phases. Whenever we discuss standard working hours, we would discuss with them our objective and also the flow. Then we would talk about the guidelines and what it would cover, such as the work nature. And after discussion, we will discuss with members of the tripartite committees the working hours and the arrangements for working overtime. That is the second phase. Phase 3 will be after Phase 1 and Phase 2. And then we would start negotiations. Elderly homes, printing and property management sectors have already reached Phase 3. We will continue working hard on these 11 sectors so that we'll be able to set out a standard working hour guideline for the sector. Currently, discussions are still underway, and it's difficult for us to say which sector we should focus on. We'll try our best to reach a consensus. Through the discussion by the tripartite committees, we have federal unions, we also have commerce representatives, and they are very familiar with the sector from both sides of employer and employee, and all three sides are very familiar with the sector. We hope that we'll be able to set out guidelines that are suitable for the sector, and with a consensus, we'll be able to set out sector-specific working hours guidelines which could be accepted by the sector.
Thirdly, Mr. Poon asked about the household survey and the cost involved. And I'll see if my colleague has the information. If not, then we will supplement it later. Whether there will be visits to the households, indeed that will be done, because this is a household survey. We actually go to the households and we'll try to get information in person from the employees. We would like to know about the working our situation and overtime work arrangements. And I'll defer to Chief Labour Officer, Mr. Raymond Lan, to talk about the cost for the survey. We will go for open tender. We have awarded the tender already. It's $4.68 million. That's all I want to say. Next one, Mr. Yu Si Wing. Thank you, Chairman. On sector-specific working hours guidelines, it's difficult to implement such guidelines in Hong Kong. We have a lot of service sectors in Hong Kong, and there is a great flexibility exercised within the different sectors. The LD has approached the TIC and also the travel sector as to whether we can try to forge a consensus in formulating sector-specific working hours guidelines, but ultimately we concluded that it's infeasible. Say for travel guides and drivers, it's impossible to limit their working hours or to mandate their working hours. They need a lot of flexibility. And for the tour guides, and you can't actually mandate that the guides work only for 10 hours. It's impossible. And after returning from the trip, they also have to undertake some other tasks. And for office workers, it's also difficult. Maybe they will help book air tickets and rooms. And if a traveler has difficulty in checking into a hotel room or getting an air ticket, you can't say to the tourist that, no, it's not within my office hours, so I won't provide the service. That is impossible. So it's infeasible within the tourist sector. I don't know what will be your next step if that is the case. And then the second phase covers hotel. I know that the tripartite committee has held one meeting, and the different parties have set out their own stances. And the labor union seemed not very willing to help strike a balance. They were adamant on their own stance, and there was no consensus forged within the meeting. And in September the 9th, the Hotel Association formally wrote in to say that sector-specific working hours guidelines should not apply to the hotel industry. And you said that the tripartite committees have completed deliberation of the coverage of the guidelines and consulting members on issues relating to overtime compensation arrangements. We're not even willing to talk further. So how can you say that this is phase two? We've only discussed it once, and you say that we've already reached phase two. I don't think you are being pragmatic here. So actually, there is no consensus within the hotel industry. So what is your stance on that? Deputy Commissioner, thank you, the member, for your comments and questions. Among different industries, or even within the same industry, there is sort of a degree of uniqueness to employees' working hours. So it's difficult to adopt a cross-the-board approach. But still, we would try to improve the working hour arrangement for employees. Maybe we can enhance the working hour policy. And we should also try to promote the culture of reasonable working hours arrangements in the different sectors. And that can help the industry to retain staff and attract new blood. And that will help the various industries, including the tourism and the hotel sectors, and help them with their sustainable development. A tripartite committee is not a brand new establishment. The LD has established such committees for a long time, and they have worked on issues of concern to both the employers and the employees. We try to resolve problems in an effective way. Indeed, it may be difficult for coming up with standard working hours for individual job types, but maybe that is suitable or feasible for other job types. The guidelines will encompass a lot of grounds. For example, we can cover standby time, whether they should be considered as part of the working hours. So the tripartite committees comprise representatives from labor unions, chambers of commerce. So we will try to resolve issues and benefit everybody. So that will benefit the sectors as well. She hasn't answered my question. If one party disagrees, do you think that the discussions have entered or have reached phase two already? Deputy Commissioner, we try to seek consensus and narrow down differences. That's the approach adopted all along. Can I defer to Mr. Leung to supplement? Thank you, Chairman. The member said that in the discussions, there have been difficulties and problems not resolved. So, in the discussion on the working hours guidelines within the tripartite committees, indeed, we have bumped into some difficulties. So we set out here that there are phases 1, 2, and 3. This is just a general categorization. It doesn't mean that all the problems or the sticky issues have been resolved. That's not it. So we were referring to the level of discussion that has been going on. We know that the hotels have their own considerations and difficulties. So the Deputy Commissioner said that we try to forge consensus and narrow down differences. If one side disagrees, we will not force through the working hours guidelines for that sector. We will only drop the guidelines when both the labor and the employer side agree to the content. So only by doing that will the guidelines be implemented successfully. And you are concerned about the working hours. We would like to also set out good working hours management measures in the guidelines. Different sectors have their own characteristics, and there are different job types within the sector. So how can we cover as many employees as possible so that they can benefit under the sector-specific working hours guidelines? That's our objective. Mr. Kok Wai Kang. Thank you, Chairman. Well, the report of the Standing Working Hours Committee was released in 2016, and it's been a few years down the road. You are still working on the guidelines today. So how much longer do we have to wait? It's been already a few years. The greatest hurdle, it seems to be the difficulty faced by employers to hire workers. That has been the pretext used by the employers. But now we are facing a high unemployment rate, so you will not have problems in hiring people. So shouldn't you be implementing the sector-specific working hours guidelines as soon as possible? Guidelines, after all, guidelines, they are toothless tigers. they will not be very effective. Please don't store the matter anymore. Try it out, and if it doesn't work, then we can go for legislation. We must ban overtime work with no pay. Well, it's a misunderstanding that we are not allowing you to work. We must dish out reasonable pay for overtime work. It should not just be one-to-one. For property management, you said that you have reached phase three. I don't know when the guidelines will be issued ultimately. One shift lasts 12 hours. If a person works OT, it means the person has to work for another 12 hours. So if the compensation pay rate is just one-to-one, of course the employer is happy, but then the employee will be suffering. It means he has to work 24 hours a day. So please don't procrastinate anymore. The employers don't have excuses anymore, and the government departments doesn't have any excuses anymore. If the guidelines don't work, so go straight to legislation. So what is your stance, Deputy Commissioner? Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Member, for your opinion and question. We would like to draw up the working hours guidelines through the tripartite committees as soon as possible. Like members, we will want to do it ASAP. We will try to forge a consensus and issue the guidelines soonest. On overtime work, the guidelines will cover this aspect as well. The employer and employee will come up with a specific definition of OT work and also compensation for OT work. So this will be discussed within the tripartite committee. So these will have to dovetail with the unique characteristics of the operation of the different sectors and the needs of the employees and employers. The guidelines will also set out clearly that the employers are required to keep clear records of OT work, and through their human resources system, such information should be provided to the employees for checking, so that both parties, both sides, know exactly what are the OT hours worked in a specific month. So such working hours records should be kept, and suggestions will be made in the guidelines, and the employees' rights can be protected, and that unnecessary dispute will not arise.
It's my turn. Well, I keep on saying that it's like a poisoned candy, because you're just trying to legalize overtime hours. Well, all along, the labor sector has been asking for standard working hours and that there will be compensation for overtime, and it should be 1.5 times the regular pay. We believe that it is actually a reference from overseas experience, yet the government has not done anything yet. Kwa Kwai Kung is correct. I don't think either that the unemployment rate is going to recover soon, at least not in the speed in which we recovered from SARS. This is actually an opportunity for us. We do not have any excuses to say that we're not able to hire people, and therefore employees must work overtime. Well,
Actually, the sector-specific guideline is just a toothless tiger. I'm sure that it will just be empty talk ultimately. In the past, when we worked on the minimum standard wage, we were not successful either. Now, my first question is in relation to the 11 sectors. Why is it 11 sector specific guidelines? Do you know which job actually has the most OT or most unpaid OT? Thank you, Chairman. We drew up 11 sector specific working hour guidelines. No, I'm asking you whether you know which sector has the most unpaid overtime work. Chairman, allow me to add on. In the paper, we said that we would work on a household survey on working hours. We hope through this survey that we would better understand the details, and we would also collect information on unpaid overtime work. And when we complete the survey, we'll be able to see which sector suffers most from unpaid OT. So this survey is not only specified for the 11 sectors. Yes. Many surveys have been done. We see that actually those working in the clerical sector suffer most from unpaid OT. These include accountants, clerks. They get a load of paperwork from their boss. And I think some government EOs suffer the same. The government is also a bad employer. So you have to finish your paperwork before you can go home, which is working till 8 or 9 in the evening. So why do you not also include clerical white collars into this sector, into this study? Because I think everyone knows about that. Thank you, Chairman. We look at the job nature in these 11 sectors, and we work together as tripartite committees on what should be covered under the standard working hours. Well, yes, you set the 11 sectors before you launched the tripartite discussions. I want to know why white collars are not included. Those in accountant or work in innovation, those working in the clerical manner. Chairman, these 11 sectors are suggested by the SWHC. Including cleaning services and those working in residential care homes for the elderly. So altogether, 11 sectors. So they include clerical jobs and also other jobs. We didn't really state clearly only clerical work. Thank you. Next, Dr. Fernando Chan. Chairman, well, asking them to legislate standard working hours is just the longest filibustering in history. Look at how many years we've worked on setting a minimum wage or standard working hours. the International Labour Day arises from this. It's like a May 1st Labour Day in Chicago. People were pressurized by the police because of unfair employment terms, and we celebrate Labor Day on May 1st. We have also tried to fight for this for many years in Hong Kong, and many years ago we've already questioned the public, and two-thirds of them agreed with legislation. 80% of them felt that overtime working hours was very serious. We rank actually number 5 in the world for the longest working hours. And 70% of the people pointed out that they are unpaid for working overtime. In 2011, the government or the chief executive stated in the policy address that they are going to look into this matter. And then they only set up the Standard Working Hours Committee. They've only discussed this. And then UBS in 2011 also issued another report saying that Hong Kong already is the longest working hour city. Now we continue with overtime work. And in 2017, the Standard Working Hours Committee decided to just set up contractual working hours. And this is exactly what I've been saying, which is all poison candy. And now you set only a 11 sector specific working hour guidelines. So you started your discussion in 2018, and now we're already in 2020. And 3 sectors are only in phase 3. And you set up some really abstract guidelines, and ultimately, because it's not legislated, people will not follow your guidelines. This is the reality we are facing. We cannot change the political system. As long as the businesses refuse to do it, then the government will just surrender. This is just a continuous filibustering. This should be a protection for all workers. 8 hours of work, 8 hours of sleep, 8 hours of free time to spend with your family and friends. We have discussed this for a long time, yet it has still not yet been done. The government is just dragging its feet. You ask for A, they give you B, and then you ask for B, they will just suggest C, and we're never going to legislate unless we see universal suffrage, Chairman. Deputy Commissioner, would you like to respond? Chairman, there's a lot of diverging views on legislation of standard working hours, and it is due to this consensus that we are not going to legislate it yet. So what do you mean by a broad consensus? Can you define that? How many percentage of people would that be? Allow me to elaborate. The Standard Working Hours Committee has launched 2 territory-wide surveys. The general public does not have a consensus on standard working hours. And as reported on our paper, we hope to first focus on the 11 sectors and to set out suggested working hours arrangements through these industry-based tripartite committees. Well, 10 years ago, two-thirds of the people already supported standard working hours. I don't know why it's taking so long. The government should proactively take the lead in setting standard working hours. I remember at that time, people didn't want to talk about standard working hours. They thought that there would be huge or high unemployment. Instead, there was low unemployment. Well, you can't really believe in anything they say because they are used to that. The government seem to think that it is all right to allow non-paid OT. If you do not pay salary or you delay the pay up, then it's actually an offense. Unpaid OT is actually the same thing. Of course, it would be difficult to reach a consensus in the market. How do you view unpaid OT? Do you have a stance? Is that a reasonable? Is it reasonable at all? Our chairman, we improved the sample employment contract. We remind both the employer and employee that everything should be specified clearly, the overtime compensation arrangements. And this is what we have been promoting. As relation to the guidelines, in our tripartite discussions, we talk about the on what the format of overtime compensation would be. Would it be in money terms or would it be holidays? We hope that these would all be drawn up specifically to protect the employees. Well, you said that you need to list it out. What if they didn't list it out? Is that all right not to specify it? What if the employer doesn't pay up? Would that be acceptable? Chairman? When we work on our guidelines, we also enhance the transparency of the terms in the contracts. We hope the employer would also provide such details. Well, enhancing transparency, does it mean that if you didn't list it down, then you know that there's no OT? So that means the employees are willing to accept your terms if they accept your offer. Is that all right? I'm just asking this question. Does the government have a view on this? Yes or no? Chairman, well, as I've already reported earlier, the our measures are under discussion with the tripartite committees. We really want them to discuss how to compensate for overtime work. I think the government should not try to evade from this issue anymore. This is actually a very pressing matter that needs to be resolved as soon as possible.
And then we've been seeing increasing social conflicts and the government doesn't have the resolve to address them at all. We won't arrive at any conclusions or outcome today, but I hope that the government can bring back our views. And you cannot say that there is no consensus, and then you are not going to work on it. Say for semi-government bodies, the Institute of Human Resource Managers have also conducted a survey. One-third of the employers are for, one-third of the employees are against, and one-third have a neutral stance. Of course, employees, workers support it, but then it's not the case that all employers are against it. And of course, employees would like to have a reasonable compensation for their OT work. So if we have a next CE candidate, please consider this. Please try to build Hong Kong into a more just society. So if there is any other member is there any other member wishing to speak? If not, then that's it for this item. Item 5, AOB. Any AOB? If not, then meeting adjourned. Thank you for coming.